Thank you, Martin, for that nice introduction. I think this is one of the most scariest things I've ever had to do, so we'll see how we go. You might ask why the title Upstream to Reservoir. This is me kind of trying to demonstrate my creative side. It's around a journey, really, a journey through career, and probably reflecting on some of the milestones in kidney care, some of the key influences, and perhaps some of the contributions I've been able to make to the renal community. And it does seem like a lifelong career in renal nursing. I've probably been nursing for a lot longer than some of you have even been alive, so it is a long time. So I just wanted to go back to the very beginning of maybe when I started my nursing career. There's a little picture of me from the age of six. I always wanted to be a nurse. It was something I always felt was in me to be caring. Off I went to Bart's Hospital in 1978. We were called Set 1. We were the first set to have to go out and work in the East End, out into Hackney and into Shoreditch. All these places that are very trendy now, but in those days it was a bit of a no-go zone. So I was one of 54 fresh-faced young little nurses going off to Bart's in London. Coming from the Isle of Wight, that was quite a transition for me. And I always remember on my first day being told by our main tutor that people coming into hospital are very vulnerable. And always remember, girls, there's no such thing as a difficult patient. And that's something that stayed with me throughout my career, always thinking about how we can do the best for the people that we're looking after. So with regards to 40 years on, so last year was our 40-year reunion, and that really brought it home to me how long I'd been nursing. And 35 of us managed to meet together on View Day, which is a day of each year of celebration at Bart's Hospital. And many of us hadn't seen each other for over 20 years, and it's like we'd seen each other yesterday. And that camaraderie and support that's still there amongst nurses is something that I think is incredibly valuable and something that we hold on to. So that also enables us to deliver the best care that we can to the people that we're looking after. So looking at my nursing career in renal, I think starting off as 1982, going through phases, doing some training, becoming a ward sister down in 1985 to 1997, looking into the role of becoming a specialist nurse, which is something I'm going to talk about, and then going on to be a consultant practitioner, a consultant nurse. So I've had quite a varied career and gone through lots and lots of different stages. And what I want to try and share with you today is how that has sort of influenced some of the things that have been happening within the renal community. So looking back at 1982, probably when some of you probably sit at primary school, very, very different platform for renal nursing. There were 20 million patients per population on renal replacement therapy, and this is from renal registry data, compared with 121 per million population in 2017. If you were over 50 and you had diabetes, people weren't necessarily offered dialysis, completely different to what we're actually seeing now in our renal units. There were 55 renal centres in the UK. We used to do intermittent peritoneal dialysis. Many of you may never have seen these, but we used to put rigid, hard catheters into patients, dialyze them for a few days, bring their creatinine urea levels down, take the catheters out and send them home. Could you argue, was that the best care to give vulnerable people? Something that we could debate later on. Things have gone full circle. We're now really pushing very hard to get people onto home dialysis. Back in 1982, everybody was on home dialysis. You were only in hospital there was no reason for you not to go home. People would come onto dialysis, and within 3 months, it was expected that they'd be trained to go home. There's a picture here of quite an old dialysis machine. These are the sort of things that they were going home with. Separate pumps to give anticoagulation, separate pumps to take the blood around the circuits. Transplantation was limited. There was absolutely no pre-dialysis service. There was certainly nothing to look at end-of-life care, nothing for conservative management. And just looking at the old-fashioned uniforms takes you back a little time in history. So, looking at my career pathway, when I qualified, I wanted to be a surgical nurse. Then I decided I'd better do some medicine. And my first exposure was on a renal medical ward at Bart's Hospital, and that was gastroenterology and getting a first taste of renal. And that kind of got me hooked. Went on to St. Thomas's, did a little bit of haematology, then decided, should I do an oncology course, should I do a renal course? Ended up doing a renal course, and then gone on from there and doing different roles all the way through. And I'm currently working as a consultant nurse in renal medicine. And on the way, became a nurse prescriber and managed to get a master's degree as well. So something that I think is quite important is I'll call it the anemia years. It was very interesting, actually. I became one of the first anemia coordinators back in 1997. And in those days, anemia management was something that was very new, very different, didn't really exist. And it was a bit of an initiative that was set up by Author Biotech, which is one of the main companies that made Eprex in those days. And I thought, well, this is quite a challenge. I'd like to do something different. So initially, it was a post that was, it was only going to be for 18 months. And the challenge was that I needed to set up a whole anemia management service. And I looked at what we had in practice. We had very few people receiving treatment for anemia, and we had four patients on pre-dialysis having any sort of anemia treatment at all. So within the first 18 months, I managed to set up an anemia service for patients on dialysis, and then has grown and grown and grown, and going from four patients on pre-dialysis now, we have nearly 1,000. During my time as being an anemia nurse and meeting up with other anemia nurses, we felt actually to enable us to deliver the best care that we possibly could, we needed to have some professional support and maybe some education and training. And I got together with a group of other inspirational people, and we actually set up Anemia Nurse Specialist Association in 2000. And we were able to then contribute to things like the NICE guidelines and able to influence practice nationally. What's amazing is that this association is still going, and next year will be our 20th anniversary. And we've achieved some amazing things during that period of time. I know I've now taken a back step from that, but sit there as a founder member. But we've produced masterclasses, e-learning, and this association has established as a national and international base, really, and a platform for debating provision of anemia services. It's now gone more widely than renal. We're now seen as a resource for people looking into anemia management in other areas such as gastroenterology, haematology, and perioperative surgical management. And in my own trust, I'm now advising our surgical teams on how to set up their own iron services. So going on from that, I'll call it the pre-dialysis year. Some of you may remember the NSF back in 2005. And the second part was actually concentrating on chronic kidney disease, acute kidney injury, and end-of-life care. And that really influenced practice in setting up services, and certainly influenced practice in my own unit. And one of the key things which I'm still very passionate about is actually end-of-life care, and that is currently my clinical workload and something that I've really progressed in our unit. I just wanted to look at the four domains of the consultant role of the consultant nurse, looking at the clinical, research, leadership, and educational aspects of the role. A lot of the clinical role is about service design. And during my time as being a consultant nurse, I've managed to set up services for pre-dialysis patients, been influential in creating the transplantation service, and I've passed that on to somebody else. Conservative management. Back in 2003, when I came into post, there was absolutely nothing to do with conservative management. We weren't looking at provision of patients who didn't want to have dialysis or patients who wanted to withdraw from treatment. And that's something that actually we've grown and grown. And when we had our girth visit from Graham a few months ago, that was something that was actually highlighted as being outstanding. So we're very proud of that. And also grown our dialysis access service. Managed to be able to be influential in looking at guidelines locally and nationally and doing my own renal palliative care. Looking at research, that's a really big part of my role as well. I was the first research nurse in our renal unit, and that was a very interesting time taking part in clinical trials. And I remember actually dialysing cow's blood in one session to try and do some work for Pfizer looking at antibiotics. Through that time, I managed to develop the research team, and again, that's grown and grown, and I've passed that on to somebody else. It's a kind of transformational role. I've done some of my own research in my MSc. I looked at quality of life and anemia management. And one of the most things recently is the experience of older people in the shared decision-making process. And this is a fantastic opportunity to do some research with colleagues and involving patients in a co-production in the research process where they actually helped in the design and in the delivery of the research. And then I've grown now and I'm currently the PI for our Centre for the Prepare CKD study, of something which I'm incredibly proud of. Looking on research as well, this is quite a first for us. So a colleague of mine, Leslie Bennett from Oxford, and I actually presented at the Association of the American Society of Nephrology. It's quite unheard of for nurses to be presenting at the ASN in those days. And we went off as two little vulnerable nurses to do this, but it's a fantastic experience. And we were actually about to share the role of nurses in what was a predominantly medical conference. That was a really big step for us. looking at leadership, and leadership's a very big part of my role, and this is just an outline from Coos and Posner, but looking at what leaders are, great leaders, I'm not saying that I'm a great leader, but it's about modelling the way. It's about what can we do to model the way, what can we do to influence other people? How can we inspire shared vision? How can we take our colleagues with us? How can we challenge the process? I've probably challenged the process quite a few times through my career. Enabling others to act. So that's something for me which is hugely, hugely important. It's actually at seeing other people grow and flourish and encouraging the heart. And I think if we can demonstrate things in our practice, this is how we can deliver the best care we can for our patients. So just looking at some of the things through leadership that I've been unable to do, within my own trust, I currently lead our interprofessional clinical leadership programme. I help to facilitate our senior nurses, do a lot of coaching for our allied healthcare professionals, very heavily involved in service research, review and design, patient safety and governance, and I'm particularly interested in patient safety currently. External, people often say I have many hats, and I think it's been a great privilege to be involved in so many things nationally. So ANSA, the Association of Pneumonia Specialists, the CKD Forum, which I'll briefly talk about, in EGTNA and ERCA, British Renal Society, been instrumental in developing the Nurse of the Year Award, and that started off as the Home Therapies Nurse of the Year Award, and we very quickly changed that to the Renal Nurse of the Year, and also UK, which is something we've just set up. So CKD Forum was something, again, linked with the National Service Framework. A little group of us got together, initially as specialist nurses, looking at trying to engage with our colleagues in primary care, particularly our GPs and practice nurses, because then there was nothing for pre-dialysis. We needed to get out there, looking at the people who weren't being identified with kidney disease, trying to get some education and training out there to improve access to services for them. Lots of education for community practitioners and patients, and then actually having set this up as a group of nurses, it's expanded to become a multi-professional group with primary care clinicians, and also we were able to come under the umbrella of the BRS, and we were the BRS CKD Forum. We were placed for several years until a particular time we felt we'd done all that we could and we could move on to something else. But we had a huge influence on things like NICE guidance, putting up referral guidelines for primary care. Been heavily involved in EGTNA and the ERCA, so that's the European Dialysis and Transplant Nurses Association. I am very passionate about education and training, and I really believe that we have to educate and train our nurses to the best that we possibly can, and that enables them to give the best care they can to the people they're looking after. So I guess through my career, I realised I had a little bit of a flair for a bit of writing. So I've written a few books, chronic kidney disease, contributed to some haematology books, and also one on conservative management and advanced kidney disease. Again, with some early adopter of looking at renal palliative care. We've created an e-learning library, so these are papers that people can be used in for practice. Currently, I'm the co-editor of that and a CKD consultant for EGTNA. So British Renal Society, this is something that's been very close to my heart, and I feel incredibly privileged to be here today to be given this lifetime award. So I've been chair of the CKD Forum, and this is something that we were able to contribute to, as I said, through the guidelines and things. I've also been sitting on the BRS Council around the table with different guises, as a representation for ANSA and a representation for EGTNA. And as Martin said, my most recent role has been Vice President for Clinical Practice. This has been an incredibly exciting role, and it's given me a lot of opportunities to work with some absolutely fantastic people. I've been very involved in guidelines and collating information, and I think one of the things that the BRS has done particularly well is to support the special interest groups, such as the Vascular Access Group and the Participation in Transformation Group. One of the biggest things we're doing at the moment is workforce planning. Many of you may have been asked to complete questionnaires and things and to help us because we're trying to revamp the 2002 workforce planning documents. And if we've got the right workforce, we can deliver the right care at the right time to the right people. And I've just recently, in the last couple of months, been roped into being the co-chair for the Patient Safety Committee. So again, that's going to help us improve care for our patients. As I say, education and training is something that's very, very close to my heart. In my workplace, I've been responsible with colleagues for setting up an in-house education and training programme. going from basics through to master classes. And our most exciting project recently has been simulation training. And in the last 2 months, we've actually had all our workplace education being recognised by our local university. So now our staff can use workplace learning to towards their master's or their degree. And that's going to be live as of September. I'm also lucky to be an honorary lecturer at Christchurch University and the University of Kent. And again, something I've been very instrumental in creating with my colleagues are patient education information sessions. This is particularly around decision-making, really encouraging patient participation and decision-making around treatment options. And we run education set and training sessions outside of the hospital, also primary care education. And I'm very proud to say that I've been a contributor to the very first Oxford Handbook of Renal Nursing, and are currently on the editorial board for the Journal of Kidney Care, which enables us to influence the content and what we can provide for our readers. I couldn't do everything I've done without support and guidance from people around me, and I've worked with some amazing people during my career of 37 years in renal nursing. People that have been very, very supportive of what I've done is Paul Stevens, who should be well into in the renal community. He's been a president of the BRS. He came to our unit in the early 90s, completely revolutionised the way that we worked, totally supported the multidisciplinary team, was one of the people that really inspired me to do what I've been able to do and supported me in my role. So I think a huge thank you from me goes to Paul Stevens. Also to Professor Kim Manley, who spoke yesterday in our transformational leadership session for Anne UK. Kim is one of the very first consultant nurses in the country and the critical care background, but she has been a tremendous support with her passion, particularly for me, for person-centred, safe and effective care. And of course, all my colleagues in the renal community. This photograph is on the steps of the Royal Albert Hall. You'll see very many familiar faces there. This is a time when Patty and John were retiring, but it was actually fantastic to be part of such a wonderful group. So here we are at the Reservoir. This is my end point in the way, well, just a second to last slide, really, because to me, the Reservoir is where the renal community sits. This is where we all are together. This is a lovely, calm picture, but we've got a blue sky vision of where we want to go in the future. We need to think about how we can continue to deliver the best care that we can to the most vulnerable. And people who have chronic kidney disease are vulnerable. And their whole journey from the point of diagnosis right through to the point of end-of-life care, they need our support and our care. And we need to be able to do the best we can for everybody. So just in the last couple of seconds, I've just got a little thing about, this is a little plug for my latest venture. So the future for me is obviously through nursing. And we have set up the Association of Nephrology Nurses. We are just 1 year old. We set up ourselves last year and launched a conference. What we want to do is to bring the nursing community together. Up until this point, there have been little pockets where we've had specialist nurse groups, special interest groups. But for our nurses working on the wards and our nurses working in the hemodialysis unit, there's quite limited access to information and guidance and education. We have a fantastic group of people working down UK. We have an executive board of 13, including paediatric representation. And one of the key things that we're working on at the moment is to set up and deliver an e-learning online renal course. Back in the day, everybody had to do the 136, which was a recognised qualification to progress through your career. That was taken away, and there's a huge need for that to continue. So what we're looking at is for this to be available in November and accessible to all nurses working in renal care. We want to promote and develop strong nursing leadership within kidney care. We want to increase the nursing voice. And we want to be innovative in our nurse training. And our nurses have got to be the best that they possibly can. And we want to make sure we've got an active network to develop those nephrology nurses. So the last stage of my career really is to take Anne UK forward. And if I can leave that behind me, that's something I'll be immensely proud of. And talking about being proud, there's just something I want to share with you, a little reflection. I hope this works. Sorry, I'm going to go back. Can you just go back to the last slide, please? This isn't going to work, is it? Could you go back to the last slide, please? No. And can you make it work for me? It's
It's got music and some little reflections. I think I pressed the button too much. Thank you. You should get pictures of them.
Reflections of the fears I know I've left behind. I step out of the ordinary. I can feel my soul ascending. I'm on my way, can't stop me now. And you can do the same, yeah. What have you done today? Never too late to try. What have you done today to make you feel proud? Mm-hmm. You could be so many people if you make that grab for freedom. What have you done today to make you feel proud?
Thank you very much for listening.